Good morning, students. Today we are going to study CB1, Business Finance, right? Now, basically, for an actuarial student, basically they are from science background or economics, studying BSc in economics, right? So they may not be having much knowledge about this business accounting aspect and business finance part, right? So this particular paper will help you to understand, right, the basic accounting features as well as how to control the finance of the company, right? How to find out the sources through which the finance can be raised, because whenever you invest in any business, right, you need to have finance. So there might be a case that you may not have much savings, right, just to start your business. So you might have to seek some loan from bank, right? So we'll explain you all the possibilities of what are the sources of raising finance, right? So basically, first of all, a warm welcome to all of you to the CB1 paper. You need to study the institute's study material thoroughly, and then we need to do revision notebook, right? In that, past year papers are there. So basically the paper pattern is like you will be having few multiple choice questions, around 10 multiple choice questions, and then you will be having few subjective questions of 5 marks each, round about you will be having 10 questions, 8 or 10 questions, and then you will be having 2 long questions of 20 marks each, right? And you will be having subparts to that as well. So there are around about 22 chapters, right? And some accounting aspects is being discussed, some finance related aspect will be discussed, some taxation aspect will also be covered, right? So it's a combination of various subjects. If you are a commerce student, then you can understand we have a combination of financial management out here. We have a combination of taxation. We have a combination of financial management, management accounting, the budgeting part, the costing part, right? There are a lot of things which has been discussed in this particular paper. Since I am a qualified chartered accountant, so I have the knowledge of all these subjects, and that is why the institute has chosen me for teaching this paper. So you need to just patiently watch our classes, right? And I hope you will enjoy it. So we will be discussing today about corporate finance, right? How funds are raised, how is it invested, how, where to invest, and basically how, who looks after all these things, right? So the today the topic of discussion is basically corporate finance. Right now, you have different managers. You have production manager, you have sales manager, right? So there are different managers in your organization. You have production manager who looks after the production part. You have sales manager who looks after the sales part, right? So there are different responsibilities, right, which has been assigned to different person, and they look after that particular matter. So production related, you have production manager, sales manager, then accounts department is also there. Similarly, there is one person who handles the finance of the company, right? Finance manager. So this person is basically financial manager who looks after the finance part. Right now, basically, the objective of hiring this person is to look after the finance part, right? Suppose I have sold goods and normal credit period is say around about 60 odd days. So when, by what time it is expected to receive the money? It is expected to be received after say around about 2 months from now. 60 days is the credit period. So now if I am in need of money, if I am needing funds, then how can I get that money early? So that is basically the role of this financial manager, right? There are a lot of, there's a designated team, CFO, controller, treasurer, right? They're those who look after different financial aspects. So basically either you can sell your debtors, that is known as factoring, or you can pledge your debtors, you can get loan against them. Like you hypothecate your stock and you get money, CC Bank OD. Further, you can go for a good cash discount scheme, right? Say I go for 2x10 net 60. Now, this might seem ambiguous to many students. 2x10 net 60, what does it mean? See, the normal net 60 means the normal credit period is 60 days. And 2x10 means 2% discount if you pay me within 10 days. Right, so this is the discount. This is how discounting is quoted. So this is all matters related to finance will be looked up by this person. Right? Okay, fine. So basically, I need funds for my business. Right? So I have to raise it. Right? So there is a firm's operation. Right? This is my business. This is firm's operation. And this is finance market, or we can say it as financial market, where a lot of investors reside. So basically, this particular person will try to connect these two, the firm's operation and the financial market. How? The process is like this. This person is going to issue shares, rather we can say sell financial asset. Now what is this financial asset? These are shares, comma, debentures, right? So basically the fund is raised, right? Cash raised. Now when you raise this fund, you have to invest in the firm's operation. So basically you invest in real assets. Cash invested in real assets. Now you need to understand what is this real assets all about. These real assets are basically the land and building, the plant and machinery, the furniture, the stock, right? Land and building, plant and machinery, furniture, stock, right? And you might have seen that whenever I sell these financial assets, there might be a case that I might ask them the funds by way of installments, because it might be a case that I may not require the entire funds as of today. So money has time value. So instead of keeping it idle, let it be with the investors, right? There are a lot of investors in this financial market, those who will subscribe for these shares and debentures, right? So basically this financial manager makes an, the process is like this, the financial manager makes an offer, invitation to offer by issuing prospectus in that, what is the profile of the company, who are the promoters, who are in the board of directors team, what the business the company is going to do, what is the projected return, what is its upcoming PL and balance sheet position, right? All those things are there. Further, there are some big shot So there are some finance companies who can sell these financial assets to these investors, and they are known as underwriters, right? So ultimately, there are a lot of ways through which you can raise funds. So ultimately, you have raised funds. Now, whenever you have raised funds, its importance further increases. You have to invest it properly, right? You have raised fund, you have promised something to the investor. If you don't invest it wisely, properly, in that case, the funds might get deteriorated. And in that case, you will not be able to return to the investors. So next time when you come up with anything good, they will rather not be interested in putting up money. So the cash is invested in real assets. It can be your land, building, plant, right? It can be stock, right? You set up the factory shed and all, you put up the plant and machinery, furniture, but for production, you need raw material, components, supplies, right? So now the production has begun, you have selling goods, you're generating revenue. So this cash generated from operations, right? Cash generated from operations, and then cash generated distributed to owners, right? And this is known as dividend, right? So there are so many steps that we have to follow, right? What are these steps? The steps are as follows. First of all, you have to sell financial asset, you raise funds, invest in real assets, then cash generated, and then you pay off dividend, right? Now, so I've already told you there are so many sources of raising finance from the financial market through these investors. And for this purpose, there are financial institution, banking companies, NBFC underwriters. They will help us. They will help us to reach investors, those who will put in money. And ultimately, the cash is raised. Now, when cash is raised, you have made some promises, right? So there are some cost of capital. Cost of capital means cost of raising funds. Further, there are some risk associated as well, right? You might have promised some repayments that, okay, fine, I'll repay you after 3 years, 4 years down the line, right? So, whenever you raise funds through these financial assets, there are some promises that you have done. There are some commitments. There is some risk involved. Say, for example, you have told them that, okay, fine, I'll be repaying you after, say, 3 years from now or 5 years from now. So I have to invest in a project in which I can generate the return in 5 years of time, right? Usually, whenever I invest in a business, it usually takes 3 to 4 years of time to get it set up properly. So there is a cost, you have to return them. That is why many investors, they do not wish to invest in construction companies, because generally a contract takes a long period of time to get completed. And usually profit accrues after the project is completed. So that varies from investor to investor, and it depends upon investor's perception, how they think, how much risk they are ready to take. The more risky the project is, the greater is the return expected. They have a direct relationship. If I invest in government bonds, government securities, my expectation will be around about 7 to 8%. But if I try to invest, if I invest in equity, right, that is stock in any companies, any firm's operation, so obviously there's a risk involved. The profit may accrue, may not accrue. There might be a loss situation. So for that, I need some premium as well. So my expectation will be much, 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 much higher than rather what do I expect from a government bonds, right? So there are so many advantages and disadvantages of various sources of finance that will be dealt in separately in a given chapter. right? You have, I told you, you have 22 chapters. So all the basic idea, I'm giving you right now, and the entire syllabus will rotate in whatever I am saying today, right? So you just simply sell financial assets, you raise funds. When you raise funds, there are a lot of factors that you need to consider, the cost, right? And the risk factor, right? Suppose if I issue debentures, if I sell debentures, so in case of debentures, you are, every time you have to pay, every year you have to pay a fixed rate of interest, irrespective of the fact whether you earn profits or not, right? So, and in case of shares, whenever there is a profit, you pay dividend, otherwise you don't pay. But in case of debenture, it is fixed. Further, from risk point of view also, debentures are much riskier because you have promised them a fixed repayment after 5 years down the line. Whereas in case of equity, you haven't made any such kind of promises. Right? So there are so many factors. Further, there is a proper blend that you try to find out, the mix. Right? There might be a case that I may not go for 100% equity or 100% debentures. 100% debenture is not possible because there are some shares that you need to get it registered, right? In basically, it's a company form of entity. You are going to see the different forms of ownership. You can work as a sole proprietor, you can work as a partnership, you can work as an LLP, you can work as a company. So basically, whatever discussions we are discussing from company's point of view, corporate finance, because I'm not discussing the finance of a sole proprietor, I'm discussing corporate, company finance, right? So there has to be a minimum paid up capital because you need to get it registered with the registrar of companies under the respective legislation, right? In UK, they have their own company law. In India, we have Companies Act 2013. So company, basically, you have to create, you have to give it birth by registering with the registrar of companies, right, with the government. And basically, it's an artificial judicial body. It takes time to form a company. There are a lot of, there are some procedural things that you have to do. You have to find the appropriate name because the name cannot match with any other company. Then you have to draft the MOA, AOA, Memorandum of Association and Articles of Association, wherein you have to describe the object in which the company is dealing, the location and the capital through which the company needs to get it registered, right? There are a lot of things. So it cannot be 100% debenture. It has to be either 100% equity or it's a blend of share and debenture. So there will be one chapter in which we will be focusing completely upon this blend. Right, I'll be talking about the mix, that is combination of debt and equity. Right, now what is the advantages of this combination, right, that we are going to see later on, right? So in short, there are a lot of factors. Right, there are a lot of factors that we need to see when you raise funds, right? What is the cost of raising fund? What are the risks involved? What are the advantages, disadvantages with a particular issue? What should be the blend? This blend is very important because different sources have different categories of risk. There are different different costs involved as well. So you need to optimize somehow your cost, right? So there has to be equity, minimum equity has to be there. Either you can go for 100% equity or you can go for a combination of debt and equity. So this part we will discuss later on, not right now. Anyway, I have raised funds. Now its importance increases because you have to invest it properly. There should be effective utilization. The word is effective utilization, right? If you do not invest in a proper place, in a proper business, then in that case the funds might get lost and ultimately it will be a sad moment for the investors, right? So there has to be an effective utilization. You have to make sure that no part of the money is kept idle, right? We are going to see that in in one chapter that if companies have surplus funds and for which company doesn't have use, so company can go for buyback, right? Infosys, TCS, Apple, they go for buyback quite number of times because they don't want their investors that their money is kept idle. If they have the use of that, they use it. Otherwise, they refund the capital amount. So that's buyback that will be dealt in. So you have to invest, right? And you have to make sure that the return from investment must be greater than or equal to cost of capital, right? The return from investment must be greater than or equal to cost of capital. This is quite common sense, right? The business is all about buying from one market and selling in another. So I'm buying from one place and investing in another place. So my return has to be greater than or equal to my cost. Otherwise, I will not be able to give a surplus to the investors. Right? If their expectation is 20% and I am investing in a project in which it is yielding only 18%, so it's better not to invest, right? So there is a chapter called capital budgeting, capital investment decision, right? So in that particular chapter, we are going to study that. Capital budgeting decisions. As you are an actuary student, so you must be knowing these things, NPV, IIR, right? So these are methods by which you can decide whether a project is feasible or not, right? And this particular part is known as financing decision. Right. So basically, a financial manager tries to play a role between the financing decision and the capital budgeting decision. It raises funds and invests properly. Right. Land, buildings, plant, furniture, stock, and the cash is generated. Right. So basically, this is return from investment, and this return from investment, usually we call it as ROCE. Must be greater than or equal to KO. KO means the cost of capital. Short form is KO. Right? Short form is cost of capital. Okay. So now, whatever cash is generated, either you can reinvest or you can distribute it to the shareholder by way of dividends. This is known as plowing back of profits. Plowing back of profits. So if you have better investment opportunity, you keep it with yourself or else distribute it to the investors, right? Basically, we have to think wealth maximization. It is not the profit maximization. The objective of corporate finance is basic objective is wealth maximization. Now, many might ask that what is this wealth maximization? This wealth maximization is basically represented by share price. The company's stock price. It should be maintained, or rather it should be increasing, right? So for the sake of investors, we have to think that their wealth keeps on increasing day by day. It should not deteriorate, right? So if you have better investment opportunity, then plow back of profits. and if you don't have investment opportunity, then better you should distribute it by way of dividends to the shareholder. Right? Now, there are some cases where you will find that you may not have enough cash to give away as dividend. I mean to say that there is a profit in your books, but you may not have liquidity. Now, again, there are a lot of analysis is coming into picture. Now, remember what I said, there might be a case that you have profits, but you may not be in a position to give away as dividend because there might be some liquidity issue or fund issue. So what is this profit all about? The profit is basically, I'm now going into the another subject, that is accounting part. So whenever you invest in this firm operations, right, by taking money from the financial market, so there are a lot of buying, selling activity going on. So you might have earned some amount of profit. So that profit calculation you have to do, right? You have to calculate the whatever is the net profit earned during the year. So that is there in our curriculum, the accounting part. We will be dealing with that separately. And there might be some more accounting related matters apart from this profit. They might ask us to prepare the balance sheet, which tells us the net worth position. So basically, let us only focus on the profitability part. So it might show profitability, but you may not have liquidity. Now, how is it possible? If I have bought it for 100 and sold it for 200, then easily my profit earned, if I bought it for 100, sold it for 200. So my profit is 100, so I might have liquidity, as simple as that. But there might be a case that you may not have the profitability. And what is that case? Because whenever you calculate this profitability part, so there are, whenever you do this accounting part, right now this is corporate finance. This whatever steps 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 I have explained, this is completely finance related matter. The financing decision, the capital budgeting decisions, right? NPV, IIR, you know, invest in real assets, cash generated from operations, and then distribute. So this is the basic steps involved in corporate finance. Now I'm going into the accounting part. So basically, there might be a case that you have profitability, but you may not have liquidity, because when you do accounting, when you calculate profitability, so there are a lot of assumptions that you take, right? There are a lot of rules, principles you follow when you do accounting, right? Here, I don't think any such rules, principles have been imposed by law, but there are some standard practices which you follow. Otherwise, if you have too much of debt, debentures, loan, in that case, if you go for further expansion, you may not get it from the market. So there are some legal constraints also when you study corporate finance. But there are more regulations when you calculate this profitability part, right? So there are a lot of rules, principles, assumptions, concepts are there that we will cover when you start accounting part. So you calculate profit, right? And there might be a case that you might have sold goods on credit. So when you calculate profitability, it is coming, it is showing you 100 rupees profit, but that particular sales may not have been realized in cash. So in that case, you may not have the liquidity to pay off the dividend. So in that case, there are a lot of other options available to you. You can go for stock dividend, right? All these things will be covered in detail in future, right? So until and unless I have this profitability known, and until and unless I know the liquidity position, how will I come to know whether I will be able to carry out this fifth step or not? So somehow or the other, these are interrelated, but these are handled by different persons. Okay, fine. My job is to raise funds and invest. Now, firm's operation, there will be production managers, there will be departmental, respective departmental managers. Cash generation had been done, then distribution. But before distribution, I need to calculate the profitability, then the accounts department will come into picture. All the buying and the selling activity will be recorded, it will be accounted for, profitability will be calculated, and then the liquidity analysis, the ratio analysis, all this analysis will be done. And then we will be able to know whether you will be able to pay dividend or not. So if you are unable to pay dividend, right, if you are unable to pay dividend, in that case, you can go for stock dividend, right? Basically, it is known as in accounting language as bonus shares. Right. So in this given picture, you must have seen that I have discussed a lot of things, right? There are a lot of things which has been discussed, right? So let us stick our discussion up to this point only. Because if I discuss too much of things, then it will be becoming very difficult for you to understand. So let us try to recapitulate that what we are doing, what we have done today rather. Basically, we have discussed corporate finance, right? And there is a financial manager who looks after the finance of the company. And the objective of this particular, the function of this particular manager is to raise funds and invest. So these are the five steps you can see: selling financial asset, raising funds. So he has made some promises that becomes cost for the company. The risk matter, the mix, the combination. This is a very important topic which we'll be discussing later. So somehow or the other, the finance has been raised. Now it's investment. The effective utilization has to be done. The return from investment has to be greater than the cost of capital. So there are a lot of capital budgeting decision, investment decisions, that how we can come to know whether it is fruitful or not. So what we do NPV. We calculate net present value, we calculate IIR, right? And accordingly, we decide whether this investment is feasible or not, wise or not, proper or not. So effective utilization is done by capital budgeting decisions. And then whatever cash is generated from operation, that has to be greater than the cost. And then you distribute it by way of dividends. So there is some profitability calculation as well, that we have to calculate the profits. We have to calculate the net worth position, the balance sheet preparation, the liquidity analysis, the ratio analysis. And there might be a case that I might have profit in my books, because when you do accounting, you follow a certain set of rules, principles, but you may not have the liquidity. So in that case, you may not give cash dividend. You can go for stock dividend, that is issue of bonus shares to the investors, right? So that's it. For the very first session, it was a very small session just to give you the glimpses of the subject. In the next session, we'll be surely catering these individual points separately, right? So till then, be patient and just give a reading of chapter number one, right? Goodbye, take care.